discrimination and soft sensing. Okay, so now just to provide a perspective of this, we looked at soft sensing. Soft sensing is basically a software sensor, if you will, that is exploits measurements from hardware sensors that are easily available and predicts what is not easily measurable. So this is a soft sensor for that variable that is not easily measurable at a frequent rate. So we saw one example of that in the earlier module when we said that we want to predict compositions from temperature measurements in a distillation column. Now what we will do is, you know, we will now so far kept, we have kept all of the behavior of the process to be linear in nature. Now many times what happens is that the relationships between the predictor variables and the predicted variables can be non-linear. Also, it can belong to different classes. For example, normal operation, abnormal operation. When you have non-linear behavior, you know, the gains in dynamic system, the gains may change, the time constants may change. And so you have different classes of operation going towards more of the on the sociological data side or the consumer data side and the like. Consumer patterns during, let's say, the peak festival season may be different than the normal season in terms of their buying. Likewise, behavior in the evenings for traffic is different than the behavior during mid-afternoons. And, you know, so there are different classes of behavioral patterns that are there in all kinds of data that we have to analyze using AI and ML. And so when you have different classes, it's a good idea to understand how do we discriminate between these data, because we want to now be able to perform the task of classification, that is assigning data points to different classes, being able to discriminate between different data ensembles and the like. So this becomes a very important problem that's related to pattern recognition, fuzzy reasoning. Why fuzzy reasoning? Because fuzzy basically is something that describes a continuum from 0 to 1, unlike either 0 or 0 or either 1. Like, you know, you can say that a chalk is white, a blackboard is black. But how do you describe gray? It's a continuum between black and white. So fuzzy reasoning becomes important here, because when you can't uniquely assign a data ensemble to a class because of a class overlap, then you have to use fuzzy reasoning now to accommodate the points that are there in the overlap, right? So all of those aspects of, you know, pattern recognition, fuzzy reasoning, all of those come start getting important when you go beyond linear variation. Okay, so I will just go through some preliminary information about segregation and classification, and then we'll start looking at some of these concepts. I will go a little fast, but, you know, please feel free to stop me, pause me at any time. We are essentially looking again at the same set of data, cause and effect. We want to analyze this behavior. And what we want to do is basically look at it from the perspective that several classes of relationships could exist. There could be overlaps amongst the classes. And so, for example, can these classes, groups, when you have a general data, a huge set of data from an operating plant or from any other system that you collect, can we identify the classes? Can we separate them? Can we discriminate between them? One example that I want to suggest is fault detection and diagnosis, where you want to detect the occurrence of a fault and be able to diagnose the source of the fault. This is typically done by comparing the data with that in a normal class and that in a fault class. If it does not belong to the normal class, then you know that there is a fault. So that's a fault classification problem and then diagnosis problem. When I have nonlinear behavior in a process plant, I can build it, I can discriminate it in terms of several, or break it down into several linear behavior, and then try to do a fuzzy classification to be able to build the overall nonlinear model. So there also, you know, it becomes quite handy. You can look at this you know, later, but what I'll do is I'll basically look at these two examples, fault detection and diagnosis, to be able to exploit signatures in the data that help us to classify whether it is normal. If it is a fault, what kind of fault? Is it a drift? Is it a fault? No, because each of them have their own distinct signatures. Likewise, in nonlinear identification, depending on the extent of nonlinearities, input and output patterns could be classified to develop locally linear models. Okay? So then we come into this aspect of classification. What is classification of what? Classification of a pattern. What's a pattern? A pattern can be a single data point that I get from a system. It can be an ensemble of points, which is also, which can also constitute a pattern, like an increasing trend or a decreasing trend. Okay. So when I get data from the plant, I can organize the data into certain patterns or features, as they call it. And then what I can do is I can classify these patterns or features so that they belong to different classes. Like I mentioned about increasing trend, decreasing trend. These are two different patterns, right? So what I want to do is I want to do a pattern classification. So what is the desirable features of a pattern classifier? It must have strong discriminatory ability. What does that mean? When I have an original data that I pick up from an operating plant or when I get it in streaming form, I need to be able to discriminate that data in a very crisp manner to belong to different classes. Preferably, there should not be an overlap. Now, how do I do this? I can do this by transforming the data from its original space. Let's say it's a M variable sample that comes in. I can transform it into some dimension where when I project this data point or the group of data points, I get a sharper discrimination between data points that belong to different classes. Okay, that's what I say here. Look for spaces that when we transform the data, it results in a sharper resolution between groups or classes. I might also have a lot of data in the archive, and I want to take that data and transform it into this space so that I can view the data that displays different groups or classes. Now, if such spaces are not built to an extent that it gives you a completely sharp resolution or discrimination, then I must be able to accommodate a possible overlap between these classes. Okay, so this is one of the key requirements of a pattern classifier. Next, I want to work with minimal prior knowledge. When I collect data in a system, I may or may not have complete information about where the data is coming from, how many classes it has. I want to preferably use minimal prior knowledge for the number of clusters, groups in the data. I need to be able to accommodate different correlation structures. For example, I can have variables. I can have samples. If I have variables, some of the variables, for example, if the loop is closed, the output is strongly correlated with the input, right? Or the input is strongly correlated, depending on how you look at it. Input is strongly correlated with the output. So there is a association between variables. If I have a fault situation versus a normal solution, all the fault samples will coalesce together, all the normal samples will coalesce in a different way. So I want to be able to detect association between samples, association between variables. But if I want to solve the diagnosis problem, I also want to be able to associate variables to samples. Now, samples to variables are there. So, joint association between rows. Oh, this is incorrect. This must be rows and columns or samples and variables. Okay. So, I want the joint association. Let me correct that right away. Between rows and columns of the matrix X. Okay. So, I want to be able to do this. I also want to be able to, one of the other desirable features is I also want to be able to look at dynamic dependencies in the data. Normally, this is done by expanding the column space. For example, if I know that some variables in the X block are dynamically related, I can expand in the column space by using lagged variables and then take a static map. But this is usually at a disadvantage because if I have several variables of this kind, then the matrix will be artificially inflated. So preferably, I want to retain the matrix structure and yet detect dynamic dependencies in the data. Okay. So these are some of the desirable features of a pattern classifier. So what I'm going to show you now is two notions of a pattern classifier. Hmm? But before that, some preliminaries. Suppose X belongs to R m cross n. Then I can look at it in two spaces. One is what is called as a row cloud. And I think this is something that you may not have encountered earlier. So I just ask you to just pay a little attention and come with me. If you are not on the same page, please ask. So there is one space that I can view, which is called as a row cloud. Another space I can view, which is called as a column cloud. Now look at what is this row cloud. This is n, r to the n, and this is r to the m. M samples n variables. Okay. So when I'm looking at n, I'm looking at all the samples. When I'm looking at m, I'm looking at all the variables. Okay. So I can project the data either in this n dimension space, or I could project it in the m dimension, which is essentially saying that I am projecting each of the rows or each of the columns. Okay, quite simply, that is the interpretation of this, although the words might sound a little unheard of. It's basically I'm plotting all the samples here, I'm plotting all the variables. Okay. Now, there is this additional notion of a biplot. Okay, why am I introducing this biplot notion? Remember that in PCA, we talked about singular value decomposition or eigenvalue, eigenvector decomposition. Okay, now that is a simple matrix factorization of matrix X into U, S, and V transpose if I'm doing an SVD, right? Where U is the eigenvectors of the X transpose X and V are the XX transpose, right? So, what is a biplot? A biplot also relies on something simple. It assumes that Xij can be decomposed in some form called like an SVD, U, S, V transpose, but here I'm showing the individual elements. And what I'm doing now is this lambda, which is to the power of 1, I'm just breaking it up into alpha and beta, with alpha plus beta equal to 1. So these two are actually identical expressions. It's just that I have chosen to separate them out like this. Okay. Why am I doing all of this? You know, is this some kind of a needless math that I'm introducing here? You'll see the importance of this in a short while. First, let me show you a simple example here. The simple example is X, which is 4 cross 3. I factorize this into a row and a column. Okay. This C1, C2, C3 must be outside of this matrix. Okay. So row, it has 4 rows and it has 3 columns. You can verify that if I multiply these two, I will get the original matrix. Okay. Now there are several different ways in which this matrix factorization would be done. Okay. I don't have to tell you that there can be several different ways in which I can generate two factors of this matrix, which when multiplied will give me this original matrix. I'm just taking one instance of that. Okay. Now, if I take each of these rows as a row marker and plot them here, okay, I get 4 points on what's called as a biplot. Look at this point, for example. This point is 0,4. This point is 0,5. This point is 3-1. This point is 2,4. Right? Likewise, I take each of these columns and I plot it with an asterisk. Okay? And I see that I get the column points. So these are the row markers and the column markers, right? Row markers and the column markers. Okay? So what I have done, I have taken the singular value decomposition of this, restricted it first to singular values or the matrix factors. And I have said that I'm going to plot them and I generate a biplot. Okay, so let me go back to my earlier slide. So this is what I've done here. I have essentially done a singular value partitioning. First a singular value decomposition, singular value partitioning with alpha plus beta equal to 1. And I've shown you an illustrative example of how I can plot this for a simple matrix factorization. Now let me show you how do I exploit both these ideas. Okay. This, yeah. But before I do that, a quick review of PCA. PCA, as I was telling you, is an optimization problem where I say maximize the variance experience along first direction, and I can show that this is basically a singular value decomposition problem, and so I determine that as an result of an optimization problem. Okay, now I can do PCA plots, which Professor Mani would have shown you, SPE versus T1, T2 versus T1, SPE versus time, and all of that. But let's not go into this. Observation of PCA, it assumes statistical independence of the samples. Okay, and that could be violated when we are doing PCA. In general, there could be serial correlations. Okay, the PCA algorithm does have some discriminative ability, but the objective function is not oriented towards discrimination. Objective function, if you see here, going back, is oriented towards explaining the variance rather than discriminating in the variance. Okay, so it's more of explanatory than discriminatory. Okay, so the direction generated by PCA do not necessarily discriminate, and it, while it detects dependencies in either the column or the row space, it doesn't detect that in the joint row column space, which is what this biplot does for you. Okay, this biplot does for you that, which I'll explain in, revisit this in a short while. But why are we again doing all of this? We are doing all of this because I first want you to introduce to you a discrimination based algorithm, which is the objective function of PCA can be modified to bring in the possibility of discrimination, which is what is done using in the algorithm called Fisher discriminant analysis. What does Fisher discriminant analysis say? It just looks at the same X matrix, but it says that let's assume that there are C classes, that is given. Okay. FDA determines directions that are not necessarily the same as PCA, such that if I take each of these C classes, the scatter between different classes of data is maximized and the scatter within each class is minimized. Okay? This is what FDA does for you. So what I can do is when the scatter between different classes is maximized, what I'm trying to do here, I am trying to make sure that I am trying to explain all of the data within that class. Okay. But what, when I say scatter within each class is minimized, what I am trying to do is I am separating the, I am essentially aggregating the classes. Scatter between different classes is maximized means the classes move away from each other in the new space. And scatter within each class is minimized means in the new space, the classes shrink in size. So when they move away from each other, when they shrink in class, in size, you essentially are able to achieve discrimination. I wish I were able to show you this with my video on. Let me show this to you with my video on, that you're able to explain, you're able to understand what I mean. You know, what we are talking about here is, the video not coming up. Can you see me? Yeah. See, what we are trying to do here is, if there are classes like this in the original space that are overlapping in one way, what I am trying to do in the first objective is scatter between classes is maximized, which means I am trying to separate them. There might still be an overlap. The second case, what I'm trying to do is, and scatter within class is minimized, which I'm trying to shrink. So what this does is, it separates the classes and also shrinks them. So it basically discriminates. In the original space, if there is an overlap, in the new space, I'll have a separation between the classes and I'll also have a shrinking between the classes that essentially separates and discriminates the classes. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to do when I'm using FDA. And so let me go back to the presentation. Okay, so scatter between different classes of data is maximized, so the classes move away from each other, and scatter within each class is minimized, which is the scatter shrink within each other. Okay, within each of the data points come closer to each other. So here is the mathematics of it. The total scatter matrix given X and given that there are n C classes, with each of the class means denoted by xi bar, I going from 1 to n, you then generate the total scatter matrix, generate the total within scatter matrix like this, the total within class scatter matrix. So this is within class and this is, within class and total within class. So I sum up all of this into a matrix. That gives me HW. And then between class matrix is basically the separation between the means, the class means and the overall mean. Right? So I'm trying to separate the classes there. So if I look at each of these matrices, I am able to basically formulate an objective function that looks like this, that find orthogonal directions such that between class scatter is maximized and within class scatter is minimized. And so this ratio, this is between class scatter and this is within class scatter. This ratio essentially, if I try to maximize J, will ensure that both these are simultaneously fulfilled. SP is maximized, so numerator is maximized. Within class scatter is minimized, so HW is minimized, so J is maximized. When I try to maximize J, it obtained by maximizing SP and minimizing HW. Okay? So if I look at this problem and try to analytically solve this, it turns out again to be an eigenvalue eigenvector decomposition given by SO. Okay? And now if I contrast this objective function with PCA, PCA can be written in this manner. So compare this. This is FDA objective function. This is PCA objective function. The only difference is the presence of SW in the denominator, which essentially is the within class scatter you want to minimize. So it basically tries to identify new orthogonal directions that separate out the classes. Yeah? So here are some observations on FDA. The objective function explicitly incorporates classification and discrimination, as we just saw. The directions will generally be different than those you get from PCA. However, it still requires an a priori specification of the number of clusters in which they classify. Sometimes this may not be known and may require an iteration. And FDA still does not associate samples and rules. Okay. So this is still a problem when we are trying to solve any AI/ML problem. I want to be able to detect association between samples and rows to identify fault conditions or the presence of dynamics. Okay. So if I look at all of this, what seems to be coming up is now, and you must have heard this word about, you know, supervised versus unsupervised classification methods or teaching, training, unsupervised training, supervised training, and the like. FDA is basically a supervised training. Why? Because you are essentially using class labels. You are assigning, when you are building each of these classes, you are assigning a class to each of these C classes, right? So you are basically building or labeling the classes. So it's a supervised algorithm. PCA is that way an unsupervised algorithm because it doesn't require any label. Now let's look at the second objective. The second objective was within class scatter has to be minimized. Turns out that there is one method in PCA itself, an unsupervised method, where self-aggregation can be achieved using just the unsupervised PCA. Okay. How is that done? Let's look at this. PCA can be scaled in an interesting way. What happened? Audio is a problem. Can you hear me? All of you can hear
yes,
me?
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, somebody posted that there is an audio problem?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Okay. So, you know, PCA can be scaled in an interesting way. So, let's start the same covariance matrix S, which is X transpose X. The scaled PCA begins with a nonlinear scaling of S with a factor D. What is this D? The D is a diagonal matrix where each diagonal element is a sum of the corresponding row of S. So I take the S symmetric matrix, sum it up all along the rows, generate a column vector, put that column vector along a diagonal, and call that matrix as D. Now, if I just do this, if I just rewrite S as D half, D minus half, S, D minus half, D half, which is the same as S, correct? And if I apply PCA on this inner term, then it comes out to be a scaled principal components analysis. Okay, because it's a different kind of a scaling which can be shown to be nonlinear because it's dependent, D is dependent on S itself. So it's nonlinear. And these are called as scale principle components. Now when you do this, it promotes self-aggregation as shown by this example. Okay. The self-aggregation has these properties that in the original space, if there is no overlap between the clusters, then objects within a cluster will coincide. You can see an example of that here. You see the pink ones, there is no overlap of it with any other cluster. You see that it coincides exactly to a single point. But when overlap exists between clusters, the objects become much closer in the scaled PCA space, which is this one, than in the original space. Okay, so you can see the spread here, and you can see the spread of that here. Okay. So objects become, so there is some amount of self-aggregation that happens, right? So this is something that will promote the second objective of discrimination. Now there is a third algorithm. We saw principal components, we saw Fisher's discriminant analysis. Now there's a third algorithm called correspondence analysis. Now what does correspondence analysis does for you? It essentially also, in addition to being unsupervised, it also characterizes row column associations. Okay. Now, how does it do that? We'll come to it in a minute. But unlike PCA, which decomposes the total variance, CA, correspondence analysis, decomposes an appropriate chi-square value. We'll see what this is. And so, let's look at this now. This is the original matrix X, and this is Xij. What correspondence analysis does is it tries to get an estimate of Xij by assuming that the rows and columns are independent. Okay. What it does is it takes the sum of this row, the sum of this column, takes the grand sum G and says that the estimate Eij of this Xij is row I times column J divided by G. Okay. This is just one of the procedures. There is actually a rationale, but I will not go into the rationale. The Eij is an estimate of Xij under the assumption that the row and column are completely independent, row I and column J. So estimation of the deviation of these values from the observed values is Xij minus Eij. Originally the Xij, estimate is Eij. So if we estimate it in this manner, it can be shown that this T has a chi-square distribution. Just like variance, in PCA. This has a different distribution, a chi-square distribution. Now, what you can do is just like you decompose variance there in PCA using SVD, you can decompose chi-square using SVD of a suitable matrix C defined like so. If you look at this matrix C, it is basically the same element, but the square root of that. And this C matrix can be decomposed using SVD. Okay, and you can like SVD generate the eigenvectors. And these are essentially important when you're trying to associate row column associations. Okay. You can also alternate interpretation of this, where you can say that X is scaled by its grand sum, and you take the row, sum of the rows, sum of the columns, a new matrix, and deflate X by that, and then apply these constraints. And that also through a regularity can will give you the same solution. Let's not go into too much of detail of that. What I'm trying to show you here is that if you do this, then it does two things for you. It essentially comes up with a row column association because of proximity of a row and a column point. Remember this earlier example that I gave you, the proximity of a row and a column point here. Okay. Proximity of a row and column point indicates an association between them when I do correspondence analysis. So what it does is proximity of an indicator, the row has a particularly important weight in the column space. Origin is the average profile point, and distances from the origin reflect its intensity. The angle between a row and a column point, if it is acute, it's a positive association. If it is obtuse, it's a negative association. And if they exactly coincide, then it's a no association. Okay. I'll show you some very quick examples here. Okay. First, let me compare the three algorithms that I presented. I presented to you first PCA, then next I showed FDA, which requires class labeling. And the third algorithm I showed you was correspondence analysis. Now, we try to analyze this using the same data, This you can find in literature, Fisher's iris data. It contains three classes, with each class containing four measurements of 50 observations. You can see three classes here. Now, when I do PCA on it, PCA separates one class, but there is an overlap in the other two classes. Okay. When I do FDA, it again separates out the red, but it has resolved to some extent the overlap between the black and the blue, but still there is an overlap. Now, if I look at CA, without using any labeling, it performs vastly improved discrimination than PCA. So I need to really compare these two, because there is no class labeling here. And when we have a class, when we don't have a class labeling, CA performs much, much better. So there is a question as to how do we determine which is the best algorithm. It really depends on the nature of your data and what kind of prior knowledge you have about the data. If you already have the knowledge about the classes, you can definitely use FDA. If you don't have prior knowledge of the classes, no, first try PCA. If you find an overlap, try to use correspondence analysis. Now, there is no direct answer. It really depends on a combination of both of these, you know, data size as well, collinearity in your data and all of that. So here is an example of the self-segregation, self-aggregation property of CA. This is an example where we have just considered a five-variable problem with a nonlinear association between two variables. And a step like what was given in X4 and X5. Now, what it's able to do, PCA shows an overlap, whereas if you look at correspondence analysis, it shows a distinct, complete discrimination between the two classes. Right? So, this is another, now here is another powerful example of self aggregation. You see that here there is an overlap between the classes. Okay, but when you do the scaling and the correspondence analysis, you see this is how they get separated. So, the classes shrink amongst themselves, so you see rings here instead of bands, and they also separate from each other, so you get a clear discrimination, right? So all of these are very powerful algorithms which transform the original data into a new space, and when you do that, you are essentially able to see a lot of discrimination in the data set, and thereby be able to classify your data and make decisions on within each data set. Likewise, an example on dynamic dependencies. So if I have a dynamic relationship like this, if I put x1, x2, x3, x4 in a matrix, there is a dynamic relationship, a row column association given by this. And correspondence analysis is able to show that. Now you see x2 is related with x1 and x4. You see that x2 variable is here and all the points are classifying around that, which means that x2 is in a dynamic relationship. The other important point is, look here, X3 is X1, X4. This is a linear relationship. You see that 1, 3, and 4 fall along the same straight line. Okay. So those linear relationships can also be detected. Dynamic relationships can be detected using a correspondence analysis. Okay. I'll just show you an illustration of this for a fault detection and diagnosis problem. This is a benchmark problem called the Tennessee Eastman. Some of you who are working in chemical engineering and must be very familiar with this problem. This is basically a benchmark to test the performance of different identification, control, fault detection algorithms. So what we'll check is, we'll apply PCA on this. Now, PCA has been applied to this, but there is a lot of nonlinearities in the data as well. If we try to use PCA on that X matrix, you see that PCA saturates. And beyond a point, only about 63% of the variance in X is explained by PCA. Okay? Actual number of variables is 52. 20 linear combinations are able to explain about 60, is this 20? No, it's 15. 15 principal components are able to explain 63% of the variation. But as we go beyond 15 also, you see that it flattens out. So it's not substantial improvement in the percent variance captured. Whereas if I look at correspondence analysis, because of its ability to detect nonlinearities, classes, and dynamic data, you see that with the same number of principal components, it's able to explain 97% of the variation. Actually, You can even stop at approximately 9 or 10. Here you explain 95% because after that there is only a, so even here you can stop and say that, you know, it's a good capture of the variance in the data. Okay, so this is what, you know, when you don't have class information and the like, comparison of PCA and CA, they have their own place under the sun, mind you. I don't think it would be correct to say that CA is a superior algorithm than PCA. PCA is meant for its own, for example, detecting, you know, similarities between samples, sample space, or the variable space. PCA is very simple to use. PCA is very simple to interpret. Correspondence analysis requires a little more effort to interpret. So they are actually, you know, while for some classes of problems, CA is better. CA achieves discrimination without labeling, which PCA is not able to do. So for all problems where discrimination is required, CA may be shown to be better than PCA. That is, I mean, I can't generalize this as a total rule, but in general, for the example that we have tried, CA has performed better. Okay. So this is the conclusion of discrimination. High dimensionality of data poses challenges for clustering. You may want to do dimensionality reduction. To suitable scaling, PCA can be effectively used for revealing nonlinear relationships like we saw in the nonlinear scaling algorithm. Discriminant analysis modifies PCA objective to bring in segregation. However, it requires class information. Correspondence analysis is most suited when the classes are not known a priori. And then you can apply other clustering methods like fuzzy reasoning based methods to you know, classify better and generate an improved understanding. So I'll just pause here before I go to the next part of the module. Let me take in some questions. I request Om Prakash to please quickly take the attendance.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, are there any questions from anyone? There was one question from Ravindra Desai. I hope I was able to answer that. Any other questions, please?
So, if there are n variables, the first thing is that is it mandatory to do the pre-processing, then we'll go for this PCA, or otherwise PCA itself or cluster analysis itself identify the irrelevant variables?
That is a good question. See, if you look at definition of PCA, it's basically talking about covariance analysis, multivariate analysis of the variance or the covariance, right? So when you're talking of variance or covariance, in general, mean centering is important because how else will you define the variance, right? You have to subtract the mean. So that is generally recommended. And over and above that, you can do variance scaling as well, depending on, you know, the extent of noise that are present in different variables, because, you know, you must have noticed PLS, for example, is sensitive to scaling. So if I have noise of differing variances in the variable, it is generally recommended that in the initial analysis, you may want to scale the variables. Variance scale the variance, so divide by the variance as well. So basically what you will then have is a mean-centered variance scaled matrix, which is a starting point for your PCA analysis. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Vita Devi, sorry.
Yeah.
Any other questions, please? Mind you, correspondence analysis requires a different kind of a scale. I didn't say that here, I skipped that slide. But correspondence analysis requires you to scale between 0 and 1. Okay, that's another you know, funny aspect of correspondence analysis. It's more suited for categorical variables. But you know, when you scale it between 0 and 1, you can also apply it to continuous variables. Non-categorical, that is.
For example, if the variables is not in a numerical.
Exactly.
So for example, you are having discrete variables are there,
but not a time series.
Yeah, of course, it's not a time series. For example, if you take the shopping, you have to predict what sort of things has been happened. So there, the product name will be, it will be different, sir. I cannot relate a Sony with a Dell or any other thing, sir. So like in that case, how the variables has been changed, sir?
Yeah, so it belong to different categories, both on, in terms of like histogram, no? Histogram is basically, when I look at a histogram, different categories, that is a categorical variable matrix, which gives me the frequency versus the class. That's a categorical variable. So CA was actually kind of developed for categorical variables, but it has also been extended to non-categorical variables.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions, please? Okay. I'll go to the next part of the, because this is where I ended. I said that, you know, when we look at clustering and classification, you want them to be as discriminated as possible, but still overlaps may exist. So if overlaps still exist, then you can probably look at, you know, other methods to do the interpretation. So we get into the aspect of clustering and classification. So very quickly, what is the definition of clustering? Clustering is basically an exercise where you find a structure in huge amounts of data. Okay, so we are trying to basically look at the data matrix and try to organize them into different groups or clusters. Now, why? What is a cluster? The cluster is that the members in that cluster behave in a similar manner, in some similar manner. That similar, what similar similarity is there that we need to define when we are building this clustering? Okay. Normally, a distance-based measure is used, but you know, in general, you can define other measures as well, which I'll try and show you an example later. Okay. Now, given a matrix X and R n cross n space, what we want to do in clustering is develop a partition in the data to reflect an important characteristic, similarity characteristic. For example, if I'm doing regression, I want to look at data points that obey the same correlation. Right? If I have a pH problem, in a pH problem, I have closer to neutrality, a very high gain, away from neutrality, a very low gain. And now that away from neutrality can be on the higher side of pH and on the lower side of pH. So if I accumulate all the points associated with acid additions or base additions to the measured pH values and plot it, I see a S-shaped curve where one of the arms of the S is one class, the vertical arm of the S is the another class of high gain, and the third lower arm of S is the third class of another low gain. It's a, there are three classes. Now if I can do a regression within each class and try to fit a line and all of that, so the same correlation is basically a linear correlation. Likewise, in fault detection and diagnosis, I can look at data points that represent normal operation, abnormal operation. Now, this has been used in medicine as well. Okay? In systems biology, for a particular type of cancer or different types of cancer, identify genes that are responsible for specific regulatory functions. In system identification, I might delve into the data and try to look at or classify the data to develop regions of different linear regions of linear operation. Okay, so that is something that I would like to do when I'm doing this clustering exercise. So let's look at a classification of the clustering methods. Now you can start with one classification, which is hierarchical. What does this mean? This establishes a hierarchy, either bottoms up or top down. One is what you call as agglomerative. Agglomerative says, let me take one element at a time, compare the second element in terms of its similarity to the first element along a particular threshold. If it is not similar, I will create two classes. I'll take a third point. I'll compare it with its similarity to the two points that are known. If it is not similar with respect to the threshold, I'll create a third class. If it is similar to the second, I'll combine it with the second and build two classes, which are, one of them contains two elements, the first one contains only one element, and I can keep on adding like this and agglomerate the clusters. Okay. On the other hand, divisive is I start with the entire data set altogether, and I break it down into smaller classes, which is the divisive kind of a clustering. So each of this comes under hierarchical clustering. Okay. The other classification is that it could be hard clustering. For example, when I do this assigning of a point to a class or a cluster, I say that a point only belongs to one cluster and not more than one cluster. That is what is called as hard clustering. Okay. On the other hand, I might even say that a class may belong to more than one cluster, but to different extent of belonging. For example, let's say that I'm looking at a bunch of, let me be a gender neutral here. I'm looking at a bunch of males and females together who belong to a certain height. I'm measuring their heights. Now, some of them are the range of 5.8 to 6.2 feet. Some of them are in the range 5.2 to 5.0. Okay. And there is a third class that maybe belongs 5.5. Now, the question that you ask is, if somebody has 5.3 as the height, will you associate that person with the 5 to 5.2 class, the 5.4 to 5.6 class, or the 6 to 6.2 class? In terms of tallness of the person, you can say that the person most likely belongs to between, has maximum belonging to the second and third clusters and not to the 5.8 to 6.2 cluster. He or she has very less belonging to that cluster. He or she has equal belonging to the other two clusters, right? So you are permitting that this person, when you characterize that person as tall, medium, or short, you will say that he probably belongs to among the shorter categories with a belonging, let's say 40% to each, but also belongs to some extent to the tall class, because anybody who is 5.3 for most practical purposes can be considered tall when you're looking at other people, especially from who are below 5, for example, right? So there is some belonging to the tall class, but it's not a completely large belonging. It's probably more belonging to the other two classes with equal, let's say 40% each, and maybe 20% belonging to the tall class, right? So that is what fuzzy clustering is. It permits that a point can be assigned to each of these classes, but with differing extents of belonging, okay? That's what fuzziness is, When we say fuzzy, it's basically grades of membership. A black, a white, and a gray. A gray can be a shade of more black, less white, more white, less black, differing grades. Basically, it becomes a fuzzy clustering problem. I can also do probabilistic clustering using a mixture of Gaussian distributions, but maybe I'll not look at that as part of this module. Okay? Now, let's look at the first one, which is k-means. In k-means, what we do, we essentially have n data objects, and we are given a constant integer k, which is the number of clusters. What we do in that space is we essentially partition by assigning each object to a guessed value of the centroid. So you guess a value of the centroid, okay, and say that you assign each of those points to that the nearest centroid, okay, and then you essentially build those clusters. The behavior within each cluster is represented by that prototype or the centroid. Okay, so this is the k-means algorithm. But when you start with, you don't know what's the centroid. So it becomes a iterative problem where you measure the distance. Of course, this is the metric that you measure the closeness of the point to the centroid. But what you do is you essentially select k initial cluster centroids in a random manner. There are k clusters, so let's new one, new two, up to new k represent those clusters. What you do is you take each data point and look at its closeness to each of these cluster centers. Okay, so dij is the distance between the ith object and the jth cluster, and there are k such clusters, right? The new k. So given this, what you want to be able to do is now try to minimize this J. So when you do this, you say there is an iterative part. Assign each element in the data to the cluster whose centroid is closest to that element. Once you do this assignment, you recalculate the centroids and keep repeating this exercise till the centroids do not move, because you have guessed it first, you have recalculated it. You keep doing this over and over again till it converges. And in MATLAB, probably Avilash can show you a demo tomorrow. Our clustering, there is a demo which actually shows you how the cluster centroids move with iterations. You can see that they eventually go to a point where they don't move any further. And that is the basic class structure for that assumed data, right? Convergence is not guaranteed many times. So solution is not, convergence is guaranteed, but global optimality is not guaranteed. Okay, so it's a non-linear problem. But there are some global versions which start with multiple initial guesses and for example, the one by Likas et al. Is a global version of this hard clustering. Okay, now we want to differentiate this hard clustering from what is called as fuzzy clustering. So what is hard clustering? As you just said, it's that an object can be assigned to only one cluster, right? One and only one cluster. Question is, can we allow for a partial belonging of a point to another cluster? And that's what fuzzy clustering does. So what you see in the left column here, Z is the set of all objects, and let's say AI is the ith cluster, then the union of all AIs is the point, is the set Z, okay? But the intersection of AI, which is one cluster, with any other cluster AJ, is the null set, and AI is neither the null set nor the full set. Okay, it belongs somewhere in between. Okay, that's what we know about hard clustering. On the right column, what you see now is the fuzzy clustering. What fuzzy clustering says is, if I have mu ij, which I define as the belonging of the jth point to the ith cluster. Okay, let me just take that question. Can you repeat that question verbally, please, that I don't have to stop sharing?
Yeah, that's the thing, is we are having different similarity function. You have point order Euclidean function, Jacobi similarity function. There are a lot of similarity functions there to right. make the points to be in a particular cluster. So is there any hint or clue is there to identify which is the best similarity function are there, or otherwise it's a trial and error method?
No, it's not trial and error. The similarity here used is the distance.
Yeah, okay. So the distance... there are a lot of measures are there.
Very good point. Very good point. And that's something I will come to when I'm solving the fuzzy clustering in a little more detail.
Okay, sir.
But in hard clustering, also you can do a scaled version of this. You can do a Dij transpose, some kind of a scaling Dij. That's also something you can do, which is not Euclidean anymore. But we can look at, understand this a little more clearly when you're doing fuzzy clustering.
Okay.
So that's a good question, and we'll come to that in a while. Yeah. So what we do is we say that the belonging of the jth point to the ith cluster is characterized by mu ij, and we define a matrix of membership functions that look like this. Okay. We impose this condition that the jth point can belong to the ith cluster where I goes from 1 to C. So C different clusters. But the summation of the belongings must be equal to 1. So for example, in the height case that we considered, a point can belong to 40, 40, and 20, summing up to 100% or 1. Okay, it can't exceed 1, it can't be less than 1. This is the constraint that enforces that it must be equal to 1. Okay, and then the mu ij is neither exactly 0 nor it is less than n, which essentially means that no cluster is completely empty or no cluster is completely full. Okay, so these are the constraints for the fuzzy clustering. Okay, so now what we do is we look at the fuzzy clustering problem, and this is the question that you raised. Okay, what we can do is there is one fuzzy clustering algorithm called C means, which says start with some guess values of mu I, the cluster centers, take each zj, look at its Euclidean norm, weight by a guess value of the membership functions to the power of m, where m is a fuzziness parameter, and call this as j, summing over all data points and all clusters. Okay, and try to minimize this objective function. It turns out that if you use this norm, if this norm is defined by appropriate matrix A, this A also plays a role in determining the shape of that cluster, and that's an answer to your question whether there are different ways or distance similarity measures. So I'll come to this when I show you an example. Okay. Now, turns out that when I solve this optimization problem, it has an analytical solution that looks like this. I can directly determine mu ij if I know the distances, and if I know m, I can directly determine mu ij. But this analytical solution is dependent on the guess value nu. So how do I know that I have that right? So it becomes an iteration. Given the data set Z, I choose the number of clusters, I choose a fuzziness parameter, I choose a tolerance, I choose a norm-inducing matrix A. It could well be an identity matrix to begin with. I randomly initialize U, which is the matrix of memberships, if you see here. U is a matrix of membership functions. Then what I do, I first compute the cluster centers by this method. Then I compute the distances of all points from that cluster center. Then I update the partition matrix. And then I keep repeating steps 1, 2, and 3 over and over again till I meet a norm where the memberships, all of the memberships fall less than a particular threshold, epsilon. Okay. So when I do this, at the end of this, I have the belongings, I have the cluster centroids. And so now I have clusters well-defined in terms of each point and their belonging to those clusters for the C clusters that I have chosen. Remember, C clusters I have chosen. Now, how do I know what is C? Okay, this C can be done. It's a critical parameter. You can use some cluster validity measures. For example, if one of the clusters has only 2 points, it's an imbalanced cluster as compared to the other points which have other clusters which have, let's say, 25, 30 points. Then you might want to merge that cluster with the other clusters. Okay, cluster validity measures are there. Fuzziness parameter M, it depends on how you choose this parameter. The boundary of a cluster, as you can understand in fuzzy clustering, is nebulous. It's a cloud, and a cloud does not have crisp boundaries, unlike the hard clustering, which has crisp boundaries. Right. So this fuzziness parameter essentially determines how nebulous the boundary is. As m becomes larger and larger, the boundary becomes very nebulous. As m approaches 1 from the higher side, it becomes hard clustering. Okay? And the norm inducing matrix A, which is what is used to determine the similarity measure, this actually determines the shape of the clusters. And the common choice is identity matrix, but I'll show you an example where a different choice of A can actually give you an interesting interpretation. So here is one example. Actually, it's an example for the variant of the fuzzy C means. That variant is what is called as, you see, the third bullet point, Gustafson-Kessel algorithm. Okay, this is fuzzy C means. Where, you know, if you look at the cluster, let's assume that, the faint background lines, which are circles, are not there. If you're just looking at the black squares, which are the data points, what appeals to you is the upper cluster is basically most likely within a circle. But the ensemble of points, black points on the bottom right, are basically elliptical in nature. They probably might well be captured by an ellipse, whereas the top points may well be captured by a circle. Okay, but if I use a regular fuzzy C means with A is equal to an identity matrix, both the clusters will be shown as circular. Okay, now this poses a problem. Let me tell you what the problem is. Okay, If I have, for example, this point, okay, if I have this point, if I have to include this in this cluster, I need a fairly large circle, okay. Now, if I have a point here, a new point that's coming here, okay, this point, it's not clear whether it belongs to this cluster or this cluster, because in this large circle, it might as well belong to this cluster as well. So the possibility of misclassification increases. And look at the penalty of it. Suppose this is the normal cluster and this is an abnormal cluster. Okay. If I have a point here and if I misclassify it to be a normal point instead of an abnormal point, then the consequences are quite disastrous. Right. So I want to be able to get a boundary of a cluster that envelops the orientation of the points as tightly as possible, depending on how the data is scattered. And that is where this Gustafson-Kessel algorithm is important, because it uses an adaptive distance-based norm. So here is what it does is, it uses a norm-inducing matrix AI, which is actually calculated from the data itself. Okay? It depends on this FI, where FI is calculated from the data itself. And once you do this, okay, and you put an additional cluster, additional condition that all clusters are assumed to be of equal volume with the volume calculation being 1, then what you get for the same example is this. This cluster is circular, and you can see that this cluster is elliptical. Okay, so now if I have a point here, you know, I'm sure that it's not belonging to this class, right? It's not belonging to this class. Whereas if it was circular, I would have misclassified it as belonging to this point, right? So cluster oriented along data variation, the cluster shape, that is the advantage of using a different kind of a norm inducing matrix. And that is calculated from the data orientation itself, okay? So this is one example of how do you classify the data. Now, there are some problems with the fuzzy c-means as well, okay? There are some problems, mostly there are, you know, this belonging that you see here, summation of mu I j equal to 1, this is basically imposed primarily to get a good interpretation of the membership functions. But it can land itself into trouble when I have a behavior like this. Now, you know, in this example, I have two clusters. Okay. The cluster centers are such. Okay. Now, FCM also identifies the cluster centers that you see as red. Okay. It took 9 iterations to converge, and it has been able to identify the cluster centers. Now, what I want to do is, I want to basically look at the same data point, but look at it from two perspectives. One, when I'm approaching this cluster from here and then departing along this line and approaching and going there. Okay. Now, if I look at as the point approaches, how the membership changes with respect to time, here is how it changes with respect to time. Okay. As it approaches here, the belonging of the point to this cluster increases. When it exactly becomes here, 0, the membership is maximum. And then when it leaves the cluster, the membership falls. But beyond a point, it again starts rising, although it's going much, much away from this cluster. It again rises. Okay. Likewise, if I see this belonging, because this rises, this falls. As this falls, this rises. And then again, it starts falling. So this is not clear as to what is happening here. And the reason for that can be traced as enforcing the constraint, which is what we saw here, this constraint. Because this constraint is enforced in what's called as the probabilistic clustering, you encounter this problem of different uninterpretable membership behavior. Okay. So what is done then is, this is a different example, but I will not spend time on this. There is a second algorithm where that constraint. So this is the fuzzy C means rest all is identical. This is the fuzzy C means. There is another algorithm called possibilistic clustering, which if you compare these two constraints, it relaxes the equality nature. It allows it to be less than or equal to. Okay. Now the trivial solution of keeping it less than or equal to one is zero. So to prevent that from happening, there is a penalty term that is also added here in the objective function as compared to this objective function. Okay, there is a penalty term added that it doesn't trivially go to all memberships being equal to zero. And when one does this variant of the fuzzy clustering problem, then one can use this for, you know, here now it gives consistent results for the same problem. You see, as it approaches here, the memberships rise, the memberships fall as it leaves from the cluster center, and then it stays at zero. Likewise, as it approaches the second cluster, it rises, it falls, and then it stays at zero. Okay, so now this is a more interpretable kind of a behavior, and we have used it for fault detection and diagnosis, and there also to detect normal faults and abnormal faults, it becomes quite useful. Okay, so what we have seen here is three variants of the clustering algorithm, beginning with hard clustering, followed by fuzzy clustering, C-means. One variant of fuzzy clustering, C-means, is the Gustafson-Kessel. And then we saw another variant of that, which is the possibilistic clustering, which relaxes the probabilistic constraint. Okay, and that gives you some benefits of being able to now interpret the classification in a better manner. Okay, so let me pause here to take some questions. Any questions up to this point, please? Yes, Abhilasha, please.
So how is this clustering with these methods like k-mean clustering, how it is different from classification that we are doing with respect to earlier PCA or CA? So how they differ?
No, they actually complement each other, because what PCA does in an unsupervised manner, it tries to explain variance, but it has some, to some extent, it has a discriminatory ability, but not a lot, because its primarily objective function is oriented towards representation and not discrimination. If we go one step further, FDA brings in class information and its directions are different than PCA, but it also gives you discrimination in terms of being able to resolve between the classes. But again, there is a limit to how much discrimination is achievable. Okay. When we go one step further to correspondence analysis, we saw a comparison of PCA and CA. To some extent, there is discrimination in CA when compared with PCA. But again, there is not a complete discrimination. There is going to be some extent of an overlap between classes. But that there is some separation, but there is not complete separation. So now what do you have to do? If you have to live with that overlap, then you have to start using fuzzy reasoning methods, because now you want to describe that overlap. And then you have to start reasoning as to what is more likely in terms of classification. Does it more likely belong to class A or more likely belonging to class B, which is what the membership functions are doing. If the membership function is 0.8, then you can say it's more likely belonging to class A and less likely to class B and the like. So those kind of reasoning can be done when you are using fuzzy classification. So okay. It actually complements those methods. It doesn't, it's not a replacement of those methods. They have to be used in a combined manner.
So there's a very sharp difference between classification and clustering, we can say.
Clustering is the task of building clusters. Classification is the task of assigning points to a cluster.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions, please? Come on. I think I would like to have questions. Otherwise, I don't know if what I have taught is. Sapna, please. Yes.
Sir, are we adding any data points to improve the clusters? Like if some data points are not sufficient or something like that to get the good performance of the clusters?
This is a very good point that you have brought up. In one of the PhD thesis of Dr. Ketan Dethroja, he used possibilistic clustering. But what he did was, once he found that there was a novel fault which is not in terms of the known classes, then he began to add points so that the classes become more representative. I mean, you don't want to have a class with only one or two points. You want a balanced cluster. So he added more points from the fault classes, and then he rebuilt the probabilistic clustering model, the possibilistic clustering model, and then he was able to show that, you know, this balance of clusters actually it lends to better interpretation. But I can also answer your question in another way. Correspondence analysis, the earlier algorithm that I showed you, that is relatively insensitive to imbalance in the clusters. So, you know, many times one can argue that there are not many points corresponding to a particular fault class, because the moment that fault is encountered, people may shut down the plant. So you may not have enough points. Okay, that point is perfectly valid, because you know, you'll then have a normal set, a normal class which consists of 1,000 data points, and a fault class that consists of only 20 data points. Okay, now this is an imbalance in the cluster. Normally, that is difficult to handle in a single go. But correspondence analysis can actually deal with imbalanced clusters, because it's looking at row column associations and it's able to discriminate that more clearly, even with the imbalance or the smaller number of sample points. So that's something that again came out of Dr. Ketan Dethroja's work in terms of being able to handle imbalanced clusters. But to answer your question, yes, you can add points in an iterative manner and then re-establish the class boundaries.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions, please? Okay. What I will do is I'll just show you one other example. Just give me a minute, I'll just project this. Okay. So, what I'm going to show you is actually a bunch of examples for this for the clustering problem. One is, you know, these are numerical problems, just randomly generated toy problems to highlight to you the clustering approaches. Now here you see that there is a cause and effect process, U being the cause, Y being the effect, and it's they're related to each other depending on what's the value of U. U is less than gamma, then this class holds. If U is greater than gamma but less than beta, this class holds. Otherwise, this class holds. Okay, and we added noise and used based on this process knowledge, we assume three divisions. And this is to look at cluster validity measures. Okay? So when we did this, there are two cluster validity measures that you see here. One is average cluster for Z hypervolume, ACFH, and average within cluster distance, AWCD. Okay? Now, we said that we'll do the classification problem with 10 clusters and see whether it actually predicts what is known, that the number of clusters are 3. And it showed that the average cluster fuzzy hypervolume is minimum at 3. And likewise, the average within cluster distance is 3. And then it stays there. Okay. So the cluster validity measures can give you an idea of how many classes are there if you use them in an iterative manner. Next is an illustration where again this is a toy problem that was built for this relationship, but it's non-linear as you can see. Okay, and now what we want to do is we want to actually find out how many classes are there. So we do use stepwise regression. We first add only UT and try to build a model. You see that the scatter plot, there is a huge mismatch. Then we add UT and UT minus 1, and that mismatch is somewhat reduced. Okay, you add a UT and YT and it is further reduced. Okay, and then when you add UT, YT, UT minus 1 and YT minus 1, we essentially see that, you know, this gives you the best kind of a scatter plot. And so the quantification numerically is that the lowest is for this value. Okay, and when we use this to basically reconstruct the Y, you find that the measured and predicted agree to a fairly good extent, except somewhat here. But this model gives you the best in terms of the multi-model approach, where you essentially try to approximate this nonlinearity. Approximate this nonlinearity by this kind of a model. This kind of a model. Okay, but nevertheless, you would also have contributions from the others, but to much, much lesser extent. And this is how the predictions would match. Okay. Likewise, when you are doing when you are using multiple models, how do you generate a prediction of the output from each of the individual? Now, each cluster, you can build local models. So let's say there are n such clusters. You can build linear models within each of them. Each of them can predict, but which of the predictions will you choose? You will essentially weigh the predictions of each individual by its appropriate membership function using this, and then you can generate the output, right? So that's how you can. So this was used in one of the algorithms which we called as the fuzzy multiple model based MPC for a nonlinear plant. And so in this nonlinear plant, the dynamics are decomposed into several local linear models, which you see here, and a weighting mechanism based on the membership was done. And when this was used for a high purity distillation column, the same example that I showed you for the Mitsubishi case, but this is on a model, not the actual operating data. When you did this, the DCS, which is the dynamic clustering space, turned out to be this. The optimal number of divisions of the operating space turned out to be this. And these are the four multiple models. You see that one of them is linear with a gain of 0.19, 0.19 and a time constant of 62. Other one is also linear with this. The third one is actually bilinear. It has A, B, and C. This is a bilinear. It's actually bilinear. Okay, you can't define a gain and time constant for that. And the fourth one is again linear. But you see that as you go to the fourth point, the time constant is almost several times this time constant. And this typically happens in a high purity distillation column when you have a huge amount of reflux. The reflux increases the time constant of the process. That's nonlinear. So distribution of time constants is also an indication of nonlinearity. Distribution of gains is also an indication of nonlinearity. Right? So when we use this in the multiple model MPC, it was able to give you much, much better performance in the high purity range. If you can read this, this is 0.994, 0.995, 0.996, rather 2, 4, 6, and 8 rather. And you see that it gives you good performance even in the high purity region. And this is the switching function amongst the four models, which models are actually deployed for the predictions. You can see the membership plots of each of them. And the other advantage of fuzzy versus crisp is that it gives you a more gradual transition when you are doing step changes. It's more acceptable to the plant closed loop operation. Okay? I think we talked about this, but I just wanted to show you this as an example. Okay, so that is really what I want to say as part of this module. We are closer to the hour. I will just pause to take questions now. Any questions? Okay, so maybe I will if you can permit me, you can permit me this little exercise. I will ask the most silent amongst this. I can call upon Chitra P and ask her to please give me a summary of my earlier module from 5 to 6:30. Chitra, would you be able to do that, or is it an uncomfortable question for you? Okay, I think she is not online probably. Okay, then maybe let me pick up somebody else. Maybe Kavita Devi and Nirmala Devi have been asking a lot of questions. Maybe I will ask Ambumati if you can just give me an overview of the 5 to 6:30 session. You don't have to be exact. You can just talk what you are understanding, and then I will complement what you see. Okay, it looks, Ambumati, are you online? Okay, no. Okay, maybe I should ask, maybe Ravindra Desai has been posting, but he's silent. So maybe Ravindra Desai, if you can help me by giving your version of the summary.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Actually, I joined late at that session, and also I was intermittently present for that session, but I could understood the regarding the how we can deal with variances in the data.
Okay. So basically what we talked about there was, we looked at PCA, we looked at advanced versions of PCA, PLS, we looked at augmented principal components and generalized augmented principal components analysis, and then we motivated the solution from the total least squares perspective. That's what we saw. And then maybe let me just ask somebody else. Maybe Swapna, if you can summarize the second session from 7 to 8:30.
Yes, sir. So we, you have told about the clustering and how we can do with the application with respect to fault detection and nonlinear process control, and different clustering algorithms like fuzzy k-means clustering and all.
Yeah.
And
I also preceded that by the aspect of discrimination.
Yeah, discrimination.
So we first want to discriminate between classes as much as we can, and once we
classification and clustering.
Right. Okay. All right. Okay. So I will stop the recording now, and